Welcome back to the Writer's Craft Summit. In this session, I'm speaking with author and writing coach, Doug Kurtz. Doug, welcome to the summit.
Hi, Kevin. Thank you. Great to be here.
So at the summit, we have a whole day dedicated to character, looking at various different aspects of character. And what we're going to dig into in this session is the idea of backstory.
Sounds good. Backstory, big scary word, right?
Yeah, I'm curious. You know, in my own approach and what I teach, I don't know if it's something I dig into a lot, or what I've actually found is that there's certain aspects of craft that I'm really interested in and that I know really well and that I've articulated in my mind. And then there's other aspects that kind of emerge organically in the process. And I think character and backstory, those sorts of things in my approach is more of the organic stuff. I'm such a plot focused author. I let the character stuff start to emerge. So I'm really interested in hearing your thoughts on backstory and character and how all those things intertwine.
Yeah, great. Yeah, I mean, I think that there are kind of two ways to look at backstory or think about it for a novelist or a memoirist for that matter. And that's that, you know, it's a big part of story. It's a big part of what makes story work, because how do you make a character arc across a plot? How do you make the plot drive a change for a character, or growth or lack of growth, if that's what you're writing, without knowing what they're growing from? So on the one hand, backstory is sort of like it's the container of all that stuff that a character brings into the plot. And on the other hand, there's the craft piece of it, which I'm kind of hearing you talk about. When you're writing a plot and you get to a point where something relevant to the character's past is coming up, then, you know, it's your job to figure out how to pull it in. So I don't know if, you know, what comes first, the chicken or the egg. Some writers are going to go into the backstory and work on all that beforehand, before they even start a plot. And other writers are going to start writing and then see what they need to do, you know, with regards to the backstory. So whatever the writer's approach, I think the important thing to recognize is that some backstory matters to what the character experiences in the plot and what they ultimately become or don't in the plot, and some backstory doesn't at all, and it becomes this burdensome load on the back of the writer to try to figure out what backstory matters and what backstory doesn't, and then of course how to pull it into the plot later.
And would you define backstory as anything that took place before the chronology of the narrative itself? You know, anything that happened before page one, is that backstory?
Well, yeah. I mean, okay, so technically anything that happens before the inciting incident. So what's the external moment in the life of this character that suddenly thrusts them into a plot, you know, gives them a plot goal or something they're pursuing, and suddenly thrusts them into confrontation with the thing that's going to change that came from their backstory? So I would define backstory as everything that happens before the inciting incident. And to take it sort of into the territory of what's relevant versus what's irrelevant, anything that happens prior to the inciting incident that has an effect on the character in the plot, right? And then anything after the inciting incident to the end, would, you know, I would call front story.
So I could see two potential issues relating to backstory. And I think one potential challenge or problem that people might have is they haven't thought about backstory at all, and they've created these characters who seem to exist just as machinations of the plot. They're just there because the story is happening, and it's like they didn't have a full life before the story started. Mm-hmm. I see the other real potential risk that people do is they come up with this great backstory and they try to dump it all into the narrative, and they drown the reader. So maybe you could speak about those two things, which it's kind of, you can go wrong on this on both ends of the spectrum. You can have no backstory and your character feels hollow, and you can have a great backstory and you drown your narrative in it. So tell me about those problems and how you recommend addressing them.
Yeah, no, that's super perceptive about what I, you know, see happening all the time. And person one, let's just talk about the protagonist, whose protagonist is just sort of a machination of the plot, is the writer who says, you know, how do I make my character change? How do I do it? Like, I don't know what the stuff of the change is or how to make that happen. And of course, the answer is, well, if you don't know what they're changing from, then you probably can't. So I think that writer would do well to, you know, go back into the backstory and start to think about the pieces that are formative of the worldview that their protagonist is carrying into that plot, because ultimately it's that worldview that shifts. You know, kind of a silly analogy, I guess, is your protagonist steps into the plot with one pair of sunglasses on, and then by the end, the lens color is completely different. They're seeing the world through a different set of eyes. But if you don't have that initial lens or that initial pair of sunglasses, then that change is really difficult to come up with. So writer one struggles with, how do I make my protagonist change? Writer two, the one that generates all this backstory and then does what we call info dump, or just drowns the reader in it, or plays it in moments that feel like, you know, they're tugging the reader out of the story to deliver something from the past. There's a sense that that material can be irrelevant or can be out of sync or out of synergy with what is happening in the story. And so that writer, I mean, there are a whole bunch of things that can go on with that writer, maybe doesn't have their plot yet and is just stuck in the backstory. But more often than not, I think they just were very kind of sensitive to the character's past. They were interested in the character's past, and they generated all this material. Like, some of them write dossiers and profiles and histories. They have masses of material, and now they want to get it all into the plot. But the vast majority of it is probably irrelevant. So both writer one and writer two, you know, if I were guiding them into this, I would send them back into the backstory for writer one to generate the relevant pieces, and for writer two to find the relevant pieces inside all of that stuff that they generated. And the relevant pieces are the same for writer one and writer two.
And what are they? How do I know what backstory is relevant and what isn't?
Okay, so the backstory that's relevant, you know, to kind of generalize about it, is the backstory that pertains to the worldview that the protagonist or whatever character you're working on carries into the plot. So, I mean, it's easy to think about it in terms of a person's own life. You know, we've all had stories where some aspect of ourselves changed by virtue of an experience that we went through. And the dynamic is largely, I think, the same as that. So, you know, first we're going along, it's life is normal, and then suddenly something happens to us, or there's an event or series of events that creates some sort of rift, or what we call in literature the wound or the fatal flaw. That aspect of the character is inflicted on them somewhere in the backstory. So maybe, you know, for a given person, it's, I don't know, my parent, you know, life was fine until my parents got divorced. And then suddenly, you know, my worldview changes and I've been inflicted with this wound. And now I'm wearing that color of sunglasses. Everything I look through is tainted by that event. So that's a big piece of formative backstory or relevant backstory. What was the event that happened that created the worldview? And I call it a formative event. Some writers have called it like a genesis event or an origin event. But it's to me the first major piece.
And so when you say worldview, I'm getting that story is about change. Your character is going to end up in a different place than they began. And so when you say worldview, what you're talking about is the way they see the world at the beginning of the story. That yep. is probably going to be the opposite of where they're going to end up.
Absolutely. And that worldview or that parasun, you know, that lens that they're wearing is formed in the formative backstory. And like you're saying, it taints and flavors everything they do, think, feel, say. So if we're in this conversation and I'm a guy who's never had anything go wrong in my life, I speak to you in a certain way. If I'm a guy who, you know, whatever, my mother left when I was a kid and now I have no self-esteem, now I'm speaking to you in a different way. I'm in a conversation from a completely different point of view. And so that's the power of relevant backstories. It gives the character that worldview, that lens, you know, ultimately its point of view that they bring into the story that comes into play in every interaction that they have, and that eventually the plot it changes or forces them to confront, so that at the end they're in a different place or wearing that different pair of sunglasses.
Do you have an opinion about sequencing, about when to think about these things? Because often what I recommend is I really want people to have something to say in their book. I want them to have a point of view. And I want that let's call it a message, right? Or a controlling idea, whatever. And so I say, let's start with your controlling idea, love conquers all. Okay, right. That's where your book is going to end up. That's what you want people to take away from it. So I say, okay, what's the binary of that? Okay, love doesn't conquer all.
Right.
That's where your mindset of your protagonist needs to be at the beginning of the story. And so what you're saying is there's a wound or an incident prior to that that gave them that worldview. So I often, at least in my own writing, and sometimes when I'm coaching my authors, it's almost a backwards approach where we're kind of starting with message, realizing that's our ending polarity, moving to our starting polarity, and then moving backwards to get that backstory that led to that ordinary world, which is what I normally call like act one or anything prior to the incident. What's your experience with coaching people through this? Can you come at this a million different ways, or is there a sequence that seems to work best?
I we're talking about the exact same thing. So sometimes I coach people on that idea of controlling idea or a central theme, and then the character's truth relative to that theme. And that truth plays out in the front story, right? So they come in with a certain love conquers all. Maybe they come in with no, love doesn't conquer all. And then by the end of the story, they're like, yes, in fact, love does conquer all. So I would call that like their truth relative to the theme or their moral arc, which is definitely related to that wound that happened in the backstory. How you sequence it, I mean, I think it depends writer to writer, but you've put your finger on these three really important places. One is that revelation of where what worldview do I come to at the end. One is the lens that I brought into the story or the worldview that I stepped in with. And one is that formative event that caused it in the first place. So if you're kind of looking at those three pieces and thinking about them, maybe that writer figures out what their best sequence is. For me, it's always figure out how that regular life in the backstory was interrupted by that formative event and what the wound was, how that wound was reinforced. Because if I know that, this is me speaking about myself personally, if I have that information, then it's easier for me to figure out what was the external event that incited the character into confrontation with that worldview and into a plot. But plenty of other writers have started with the revelation, the old, start with the ending and work back to the beginning. I think that's another way of saying what's the aha moment at the end of the novel that your protagonist comes to and how do you get them to that? But all these pieces are in interaction all the time.
I've seen a couple different times with clients of mine early in the book, like literally chapter one, I'll say that week, go work on chapter one and we'll see what you got next week. And then they come back next week and I'm like, okay, how's chapter one and chapter two looking? And they're like, well, actually chapter one is now chapter two. I realized there was something to tell before that. Yep. And then we go forward and then the next week, the same thing happens and they actually start writing backwards.
Just like walking back in the plot. Yeah.
And I think what they're doing is they're walking their way backwards into that backstory. I think
they
recognize that there's something missing there and they're trying to find it by writing backwards, which is interesting.
Absolutely. It just happens to so many writers. And I think that what we're talking about is the ability to see the inciting incident as an external moment that prods that wound. And if you don't know what that wound is, I think you do keep moving backwards. Like, well, wait a minute, first this happened, then she got there, then this happened. And so getting that information or working on those pieces that we're talking about, super important, because if you know that wound, and there are different ways to frame, the wound is such a like literature word that kind of is nebulous, but I think some people have called it a misconception about self, a false belief about self, a wrong opinion about self. So if you know what that opinion is and how it stems from the formative backstory. So going back to that silly divorce idea, let's say that, that was your formative event, parents divorced.
That was my formative event.
It was mine too.
That's not a silly formative event at all. That colored my entire worldview.
And so let's say that your false belief is it's my fault. Mm-hmm. Okay, it's my fault. My parents got divorced. Maybe that's the opinion that you carry about yourself. I am to blame. And then you go on through your life and your backstory and other things happen and you fall back on that idea. Gosh, I'm to blame. I got fired from my job. I'm to blame. My relationship ended. I'm to blame. Pretty soon you're wearing I am to blame glasses. Okay. And then one day something external happens in the plot. Or, happens in your life. And suddenly you can't get away from I'm to blame. The inertia of belief that you've been settled into for so long suddenly gets jarred And now you have to look at that. Like, oh my God, I'm to blame is staring me down. I'm in a plot. Here we go. I have to start dealing with events and I have to start looking at myself, you know, in relationship to those events and seeing how I'm going to change. And so knowing that external event and its relationship to that false opinion or misconception that I'm to blame is what can keep you from having to continuously backpedal, right, into the nebulous sort of open space of backstory.
And I think this discussion is such an interesting example of how character and structure and all of these things are so intimately tied together. Because my own worldview is that people are very broken. People, as they go through life, terrible things happen to them. And for the most part, it kind of breaks them down. That's the lens through which I see the world. Yeah. And so for me, this idea of knowing your character's backstory and ensuring that that backstory has wounded them in some manner is just part of creating characters that feel real. Like, to me, the world feels hard and I feel broken. So I want to read about characters who have been broken in some way in the past and are now struggling with that. And, you know, that wound or that lie or whatever is a part of the external challenges they need to overcome. Yeah, we all need to overcome what the plot is throwing at us, but we also need to overcome, you know, maybe even more importantly, that thing that's screwed up inside of us.
Absolutely. And it doesn't really matter if your wound is I'm to blame, and then you're suddenly in a plot about aliens attacking New York City, you know? That wound that you're carrying still comes into play because it's how you respond. It's what you do in that plot. And ultimately, I mean, if you look at any movie or any novel, what shifts or changes or doesn't at the end? I think it's important to say, too, though, that just kind of along the lines of what you were just saying, is that it's not always, not every story is going to be some god-awful wound, you know? It's not always
all
like,
of mine are going to be.
Well, yeah, mine are, too.
Other people have a better lens through which they see.
But maybe you want to write about, you know, pets or like a pet story or something, and the false belief is, or the false opinion is, I'm a dog lover, not a cat lover, and that's what changes. I think that, you know, for me, that's not going to be as interesting, but the point being that it's some preconception that the character's carrying that shifts across the plot, even if it's as lighthearted as dog lover versus cat lover, or as dire as, you know, I'm to blame for everything that happens in my life, or mommy doesn't love me, or whatever it might be.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at Nick Carraway, the narrator of The Great Gatsby, like, he's got it pretty much together, but his, like, lie or his worldview is that, you know, like, class transcendence is possible, and that, you know, like, the American dream is possible, and that rich people are generally good people or whatever. And by the end of the book, he's realized none of that is the case.
Not so much,
but it's not like there's something wrong with him. It's just that he had a certain perspective about the world. And I think the opening line of the book even is like, you know, my father always told me, boom, there it is. There's the backstory that that belief.
That's really important what you just said too, because, you know, then the writer can't help but think about structure. You know, you kind of get into this head holding moment of, oh my God, you know, like, what do I put on the page first? Do I put these backstory pieces on the page? Are they subtextual and implied? Are they just kind of glanced against, like that first line? And the answer is, depends on what you're writing, right? Like, I just read The Knicks by Nathan Hill. First line, formative event, mom left me. Now I'm like this, you know? My Absolute Darling, another great recent novel about, oh God, I don't know if I should have brought this up, but like sexual abuse and the false belief that that instilled in the character and the emotional impact and like just thrill and emotion of her getting past that in just a little way at the end, that worldview just shifting enough to move her, so impactful. But without that backstory, the relevant backstory that forms the worldview, that's just not available.
Something I wanted to touch on in this conversation was flashbacks.
Oh man.
Because for me, I'm you know, I write action, horror, adventure stories. I want to be driving my plot forwards. Yeah. I do not want to stop everything dead with a flashback to backstory. But of course, the way I like to write and the books I write are different from the books other people write. And so do you have any general thoughts or tips on how do you handle flashbacks and their relationship to backstory?
Well, I think genre plays a big role. I mean, if I'm reading a detective novel or something like that, or like some kind of police procedural or something, and the backstory is, you know, I'm to blame for my partner's death on our last case, and now I'm coming into this case, and here we go. I don't want to spend a whole lot of time probably delving into what happened in the last case. Maybe it's going to get glanced against. Maybe there's going to be a conversation about it. Maybe there's a flashback to the moment of blame when that partner died. And I think the key is to just play it in the right place. You know, play it when the conflict that's happening in the plot pertains to that backstory, so that the effect on the reader is, I can't turn another page until I know how his partner died, you know, so that there's a need to deliver it, that it's serving the front story in such a powerful way that it's not going to feel like a diversion. You know, the kiss of death is when backstory and flashback is getting dumped in and it's irrelevant to what's happening, or it's out of proportion to what's happening, or it's not relevant to who the character is. The way I write, I don't like to use that much of it, really. And in my last novel, Mosquito, I opened with the formative event as part of the structure and then didn't do any backstory after that. I mean, I think it's a kind of a personal question, but if you don't want to annoy the reader, there has to be a magnetic relationship between what's happening and the backstory or the flashback that you give them.
I think you just hit on something really important here, is that just because your story needs backstory, just because your character needs a backstory, doesn't mean it ever has to literally appear on the page.
No, but if you, okay, so writer A knows their formative backstory, writer B doesn't. And neither of them's going to put a sentence of flashback or backstory in. Writer, I can't remember who was who now. Writer B knows the backstory, and because she knows the backstory so well and so deeply in all those formative pieces, it comes out as subtext. Like the reader can feel some kind of depth. They can see in the actions and the dialogue something more to that character because the writer knows those pieces. Writer A doesn't know those pieces. They have the two-dimensional cardboard character who's moving through the plot, and there's no sense that something caused this person to be like this. Something made this person who they are. So whether you play it or not, whether you leave it all implied and subtextual, or whether you just dump reams of it, like that book I was just talking about, Nathan Hill, it's got tons of backstory in there. You got to know it. You have to know it.
I think.
Yeah.
So important. Well, Doug, any other kind of final or closing thoughts on this idea of backstory and how authors can use it effectively?
I think as a closing thought, the most important thing to me is just to pay really close attention to which backstory affects the character in the plot that they're in. And maybe to know that backstory that isn't formative or relevant might still be important to the writer to get to that other stuff, and might be fun to do, but ultimately it's more important to the writer than the reader. All they care about are the pieces of backstory that made the character who they are when they step into the plot and that are going to show their change at the end.
Well, Doug, I know you have a really cool system that you've developed, a structural approach to storytelling, and backstory is a part of it, as are many of the other elements of writing that we're covering throughout this summit. So do you maybe just want to give people a taste of that system and where they can find and learn more about it?
Sure, yeah. It's called the Story Map. And what it is a diagram of the pieces, the elements of story, like what makes a story happen. And of course, you know, formative backstory is part of it, inciting incidents part of it, that aha moment or revelation that we were talking about is part of it, theme, which we hit on, is part of it, voice is part of it. So what are all the pieces and what are their relationships? How do these pieces come together to make a successful story work? And if you have a map, it's not a formula or like a plot structure or some deeply mechanical thing that you have to follow page by page. It's a set of ideas and their relationships to each other. And so if you map your story in that way, if you think about these pieces as they pertain to your story, you can see when and it is working, when it isn't working, what you've thought about and what you haven't. So it's been a really powerful, helpful teaching device and way to think about how a story works. And Oh, go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, and something I love about it is this idea that you've built layers into it. You know, it's not like a map in like ABC, here's how we're going to travel across the country. It's more like a topographical map. You know those maps that have the lines showing a mountain kind of going up?
Yeah.
More what you've built here, right? This idea that these things are all functioning on top of one another at different levels.
Yeah, they're layered on top of each other, and some you see explicitly in the text, and some are the pieces that the writers thought about that the reader can feel. But yeah, there's kind of an overlay of the pieces of the map. So one of the overlays pertains to character. You know, what is a character? How do you make one? What does that mean? And a lot of what we've just talked about, you know, about formative backstory is a piece of that part of the map. And then overlaid on top of that is plot. You know, something's happening, a person's doing things, they're changing, you know, there's action, there's conflict. What are those pieces and how do they relate to those character pieces? What's the relationship between those pieces? How do they interact together? And then overlaid on top of that is theme. What's the message? What does it mean? What are you trying to say? Voice, which encompasses the entire thing. The author's voice, the protagonist's voice permeates your worldview, permeates anything that you write. So if you think about that, overlaying on top of all these other pieces, you can get a tremendous amount of insight about what you're writing. Your awareness goes up. How can you make it better? It's cool.
Great. So where can we send people to learn more?
You can send right now people to my website, dougkurtz.com. Yeah. Or breakthroughwritingretreats.com has the story map on it also. And there you would find a little interactive version where you can click on it. It gets big. And then if you hover over the bits and pieces, it'll tell you a little bit about what they are.
Fantastic. Yeah. Awesome. Well, Doug, thank you so much for taking time to join me on the Writer's Craft Summit today.
Oh, it was great. Super excited. Yeah.